When I saw Luke's presentation, I saw 150 years BASF, and I mean, I was a BASF for a longer time. It's a good company. Interestingly, Benson Hill is 150 weeks old. I just figured that out. Much younger, and also in a small company, things move a little faster. That doesn't mean that it's always going in the right direction, but I'm enjoying this. Let's get into this here. This is a slide which certainly you all know. That's the motivation why anybody in the small and in the big companies is working on improvement of yield, because the yield requirements are definitely much higher than the projections of what you obtained in the past. That's known. That's why there are modern breeding and transgenic approaches, and these are just the biggest crops. Of course, it also is true for others. And this slide is actually from the Monsanto BASF collaboration. It's published and sees or shows that actually these next generation traits, which are here in the upper left corner, or is it right? Is it right? Are certainly the most attractive traits to work on because of the need and of also the value which you can extract. Nevertheless, I mean, Luke talked about herbicide tolerance. There's certainly also I would say, a new wind, fresh wind blowing in the herbicide area because of needs of resistances coming up, new herbicides needed. Nevertheless, Benson Hill is focusing on what you said, intrinsic yield. Intrinsic yield, it's a little difficult. You would have to define this as the plant really has more potential to grow faster. We try to do this, and I'll show you in a minute how. Benson Hill, we call ourselves also the photosynthesis company. I'll show you that on the next slide. We really focus on, oops, sorry, some formatting things happened, on everything around the Kelvin-Benson cycle, and of course, regulating it. Energy metabolism, light harvesting complexes, starch production as well, and sugar. So mainly on the source, but also partially look at starch on the sink side. Why? Because photosynthesis is obviously a very central mechanism, and we realize that this is something that the big companies don't really focus their attention to. And also, there is a potential, I don't have that slide here, but there is a potential to really increase this, what you said, intrinsic yield. Okay, let's see. I mentioned the photosynthesis company. That's how we branded us after I joined. And this is a little complex here. What I want to say, the differentiators or the points how Benson Hill Biosystems, I would say, really is different than all the other ag biotech companies are. We have a deep knowledge on photosynthesis. You can consider us as a spin-off company from the Danforth Center, which is in St. Louis, not here, in Missouri. But we are also here. And that actually speaks for the RTP area, by the way, because the only reason why we are here is because there are so many talents in RTP, and all the people joined Benson Hill lived here and wanted to stay here. And there are so many potential customers and partners here in RTP. Honestly, that's the reason. We also have a lab here, but the majority certainly is around photosynthesis. Tom Brudnell and Todd Magla from the Danforth Center are our chief scientists. And so this one here, plus we call it PSK-based, photosynthesis knowledge-based. That kind of is how to do RNA-seq experiments, right? Also transcriptome experiments. And with obviously modulations of photosynthesis, I have two, three examples later on. And how to make books. And how to make sense out of it. Also, how to analyze, we call it network plasticity. And I'll show you this in a minute. Of course, anything else downstream, we have also, we do phenotyping and we do field testing. But I mean, I would say we do this good, but that's not the differentiator. The differentiating points are here and here. Right now, our outlet is gene-based modifications. This is transgenic approaches. We are also exploring the genome editing. approach in order to, even if Europe is not yet prepared or doesn't know what it wants, in order to be able to maybe deliver a non-GM or considered non-GM product. But certainly, this is the majority of our outlets. Synthetic chemistry is also something in biologicals, but that is, I would say, an upside potential of our platform. All right. And I mentioned before the areas where our trait candidates are actually focused on, as all around photosynthesis, and that is indeed the case, but I mean some things like, and all based on RNA-seq experiments and on this network plasticity analysis, but some things you cannot get through these approaches like, let's say, CO2 concentrating mechanisms or so. These are genes which we in-licensed from elsewhere. Also, starch is not exactly in our core, so we in-licensed genes there, genes from universities and research institutes. And so this is a typical upside-down pyramid, and let's focus on the first part, and I want to show you how we do this. How is the deep knowledge for the synthesis RNA-seq actually working? This is one experiment which we performed, which really was a source for many candidate genes, which are partially now already in crops and tested in the field this year, most of them next year. So here, these are three different C4 plants. Sorghum, corn, Zeteria, and as you know, maybe if you look through to an individual leaf, actually, if you start at the base, that is, so to say, a very young tissue. If you are at the tip, that's a really old senescing, almost senescing tissue. So you have kind of a developmental pattern profile here. And what we also did here in this case, we isolated the different cell types, mesophyll and bundle sheath cells, and from these species, and then performed RNA-seq. Because, I'll show you that in two slides later, it is important to have different, either developmental stages, cell types, and environmental factors in order to really understand what are the important networks and what is limiting under which condition. So another experiment, more recent, was we performed the same kind of experiment with wheat, and here, also different sections, but under different grown under different CO2 concentrations, these wheat plants. And that is not only interesting in the light of increased CO2 concentrations in the what is already happening, but also it just showed us what is really a key regulator in photosynthesis in CO2 assimilation. So it was a kind of a double pitch. And I talked about this network plasticity analysis. So that is the real key, honestly, because you can do RNA-seq experiments elsewhere. It's not so difficult. But as you know, a gene co-expression network is based on regulatory relationships, and these change from genotype to genotype, from developmental stage to another stage. Tissues, environmental factors, and that's exactly how we design our experiments to identify those candidates. That's not all. I want to show you here a few examples. In this case here, you can see these are, for example, transcriptive factors which we pulled out from that experiment where we did RNA-seq and network plasticity analysis from the C4 plants I showed you earlier, corn, Zeteria, sorghum. But we also express these under the control of four different promoters. A would be a constitutive promoter, B, C, and D are leaf specific and have different expression patterns. And two of them are actually CMI, we call it CMI, CMI synthetic, so we actually used regulatory elements and fused them into another promoter to enhance the specificity and, of course, tested them. So we have a large promoter program in place and are even further working on it, also to make it even bigger. And also, we have an idea what is the right time point. We still don't know, so that's why we really do this matrix and express candidate genes under several promoters. And here you have some, this is Brachypodium, a model plant, which we use. We also use rice as C4, as C3 plant. And of course, we have Zeteria as our model for C4, also for corn, let's say, and for sugarcane. On this page, you can see, interestingly, Not a single of these transcription factors showed any effects with a constitutive overexpression. However, we saw phenotypes from really enormous biomass, but very delayed flowering towards a yield increase and also seed yield and vegetative biomass increase. And some of these are now in other models and in already in crops. So we are waiting for the crop results this year in the field. Other models we already have. Here's a very recent one. Come up with the 150. I think this is the patent was filed about 150 minutes ago. This is kind of the result of. I really like that when you go to some research labs and they work for 10 years on a certain topic, and great things come out. I can't really say that this example came from Tom Brudnell's lab, and I mean he is working on photosynthesis on C4 for years. And here, this is a very C4 specific approach, so it has no meaning in any wheat or whatever sugar beet crop. But certainly, it makes a lot of sense in corn or also in sugarcane, for example. And so, very very smart approach using the right promoter. We tested this in Cetaria in our C4 model plant, and see there you have an enormous lever. Very impressed biomass and also seed weight increase. In the case of Cetaria, the plant sets more tillers. Some people say that's good and some that's bad. But in the end, I consider this a model plant, and Cetaria just doesn't know what to do with all the extra carbon it has, so it sets a new tiller. Can be different in corn because we do not affect tillering as such here. So this is just one more example from our platform. And I mentioned the platform. Obviously, photosynthesis is such a universal mechanism in plants that the product opportunities are actually broad. Of course, C3, C4, but we cover both with our models. And these parts of the platform, I mentioned them at least partially. Yeah, I think I mentioned all of them. And obviously, as a startup company, having only one product candidate is a mistake. So here we have a whole platform of right now, in the range of 60, 70 candidates already transformed into corn even. And of course much more in model plants. This is, I think, quite likely that we find some which really work. And talking about partnerships, this was announced just, I think, about 150 hours ago. Yeah, it was. It's true, on April 2, I think that's quite accurate. So it just shows that Limmark really believes and trusts us, and I mean they ripped very much detail into our platform, and we work together with them in a very collaborative way in wheat and in corn. We don't throw things just over the fence, but also we use their genomics and genetics discovery work to really make sure we put the right candidate into this collaboration. And what's really stunning, and I'm maybe others of you know it better, but I'm very impressed actually how far we got so far with just 2 million seed funding. So we are still in the seed round. We intend and we will close the Series A at the end of the end of this quarter. But right now we have a validated platform. We really already have some data in several models and also some indications in crops that it works, some preliminary data in crops. Obviously our platform is broad. I mentioned that earlier. The pipeline is really operational. We have that Cetaria, which is unique because honestly no other entity in the world is transforming and also growing and validating such a C4 model in such a speed. I mean the generation time is really just 12 weeks. So this is very fast. Crop transformation is ongoing and we are performing field trials this year. Yeah, they're almost done with the bike up actually. Well, I think we have a good team. It really is fun to work there. And already last year, we signed deals with Simplot and with CTC, as a Simplot in potato and CTC in sugarcane. Very recently with Limagrain in corn and wheat. These are the big partnerships which we have. We also have, well, that is caused by the collaboration with CDC, a subsidiary in South America, but we're also looking into other regions. And how is it possible? Yeah, also because 2 million is really not much money to go so far. I call it CapEx light. You know, we are a spin-off of the Danforth, so we use a lot of facilities, we have agreements with them, but it is a really good environment, not only intellectually, but also infrastructure-wise. Well, we have revenues from our deals, and of course also grants, which we are working on, which we are heavily projects running. And here's a funny thing, or it's kind of striking. Later this year, we will have a point where we'll have actually more revenues from our partnerships than from our venture capital. I think this is quite interesting for a 2-year company, a little more than 2-year company. So thank you very much.